Mina, konbanwa, JesusFreakinGamer here. Since my sound is now working, I'm going to do a full 30-minute sermon. Well, okay, maybe not 30 minutes, maybe 20 minutes. Maybe even as short as 10 minutes. It's not going to be 2 or 3 minutes. This is going to be an actual study, and a lot of this is going to be because of my trip out of state to see my dad's dad, who's dying of cancer. If that brings up immediate questions of death, mortality, and what I believe to be the most important question that can be asked. And you're going to hear various versions of this, even from Christians. You know, some would say, you know, what do you believe about Jesus Christ? Who do you say that I am? A quote out of the Gospel of Matthew, which Jesus addressed to his disciples. You know, do you know where you're going to go when you die? That's close to the one that I would ask. And that I'm going to present in this video. So there are many, variations of, you know, you need to come to Jesus, you need to believe in Jesus, and I totally agree with that. I'm a Christian. I'm a conservative, evangelical, charismatic Christian, to be even more precise. So I believe in all that stuff. The way I would phrase this most important question, because I feel it gives it the appropriate amount of logic in accordance with the eternal repercussions of the answer. And that question would be, am I going to heaven when I die? That question includes any possible way to go to heaven. It includes a possible looking into of all religious faiths and beliefs. And I think within the wording of that question, am I going to heaven when I die, that even includes the possibility of heaven not existing. You know, what if it's not heaven? What if it's absolute nothingness? Like the atheist would say, what if it's reincarnation? Like Hinduism and Buddhism would say. Even though they have versions of heaven. It's not the same heaven as what the Bible. I always point over here because I put my Bible to my left-hand side when I'm talking. So is my Bible, again, see, that I'm talking about. So I want to go over a few specific verses today, and I want to do a little bit more of a study, biblically, on am I going to heaven when I die? I believe that Jesus is the way, so I'm not going to look into alternative heavens today. That's not the purpose of today's sermon. That's not my overall goal. Hopefully at some point in the future, I will get a chance to go into other religious faiths, even other heavens that are talked about by different religions that I do not believe to be true. So for this video, we're going to be focusing on, you know, the Christian heaven. I wouldn't even say the Jewish heaven. I would say more the Christian heaven. Because as I was preparing for this message, I looked in the Old Testament and I kind of thought about, okay, heaven and its counterpart, hell, and what does the Old Testament have to say about it? Because that's part of the Bible too. And the Old Testament is, maybe strangely ambiguous isn't the proper terminology, but I don't know. I would just think that, you know, hey, where I'm going when I die, that's pretty important. If there is somewhere I'm going other than the dirt when I die, that's a pretty important question to have answered. I believe it's the most important question because within that question is answered, you know, which God should I worship? Which God is going to win in the end? Will this world last forever? Are there multiple steps to get to this ultimate spot? Is this ultimate spot eternal? Is it itself temporary? You know, which God do I have to believe in? What steps do I need to take? Which faith do I need to partake of? Is it even real and a possibility to go there? I think within that question, am I going to heaven when I die? I think that question encapsulates all of those other questions and possible eventualities. So I'm going to start with the Old Testament since we're coming at this from the Christian perspective. Again, maybe I'll go into different perspectives on heaven and hell from other religious viewpoints at another time. Today, I'm going to focus on my faith, what my Bible and my God says. We're going to kick it off with Job chapter 19, verses 25 through 27. I myself have not opened my Bible or set little markers and cursors along those lines. Yes, it's a very beat up, raggedy old Bible. There's a saying out there that if you see a Bible that's worn down, beat up, you'll probably find a person that is not. I like that saying a lot. So I'm going to turn to Job chapter 19. It's right before the Psalms. Oh, cool. Psalms are basically near the middle of the Bible, so you go to the left and boom, you got Job. Quick side note, because I like tangents, I kind of miss the days when there weren't just video projectors with the Bible verse, the book, the chapter, and the verse, and the entire verse printed out on some screen for everyone to see. I mean, it's not like flip phones and tablets make it so easy as to where, okay, Job 19:7, bloop. Search for that online. That's pretty friggin' easy. I kind of miss the days when you had to go and flip through a book. Because to me, that makes you have to remember where things are in the Bible. Like, to draw a kind of an analogy, do you know your loved one's phone number by heart? Or do you just hit their contact on the contact list? Do you know an emergency number other than 911 by heart? Or do you have that in your contact list as well? When things are automated, we humans tend to be lazy creatures, quite frankly. I know I cop to this. I don't know my loved one's numbers. I don't know my emergency contact information or numbers by heart. I don't know any of that because it's all on my cell phone. It's all automated. And when I became a Christian way, way, way back in ancient times, because I am so old, all we had was the Bible. Smartphones didn't even exist, and the internet was just barely alive back in the early 90s, and I got saved in an old-timey Southern Baptist church as well. So, I had to bring my Bible, and if I wanted to find stuff, I had to flip to it or just take the preacher's word for it. When you look on a screen, it's the same thing. You're taking the preacher's word for it, and did all the notes for the screen projector, you're taking his word for it that they got it right. I don't want to take anyone's word for it that I got the Bible right. I don't want to take anyone's word for it that I'm going to heaven right. I want to look into it for myself. I want to study it for myself. I want to know it for myself. So if there is a heaven to go to when I die in some ultimate eternal ground that is unchanging and I'll be there forever, if all that's true, I want to know. I want to know which God to serve, which religion to partake of, what duties to perform, how many handstands I have to do, how many blowjobs I have to give, whatever it is. Yes, I just said that in a preaching video. Whatever it takes. Whatever it takes. I want to make sure I get there. Because if there's a good place to go to, as opposed to several other layers of not so good places or even a horrible place like hell, I want to know about it. And I want to make sure I go there. And I want to make sure I do whatever it is I need to do, believe whatever it is I need to believe, worship whoever it is or whoever they are that I need to worship to make sure that I go there. Are you at there? Are you at Job? At Job 19, verses 25 to 27. You can pause the video if you need to. I'm there. I know the Bible pretty well. I've made it a purpose to know the Bible pretty well because I want to know who my God is, and I want to know what He says in His Word, and I want to know where I'm going to go when I die. Job chapter 19, verses 25 through 27. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and He shall stand at last on the earth. And after my skin is destroyed, this I know, that in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not another. How my heart yearns within me. So, all of this is in the Old Testament. These are some very specific things, that God will stand on the earth. Obviously, even in the Old Testament, it was obvious God was in heaven, not on earth, at least not after the Garden of Eden incident. God was no longer like in some kind of physical manifestation on earth. He was elsewhere. Well, at last on the earth, He will stand. So, there's going to be an ending to the world. God's going to be here, And even after my skin is destroyed, or death, I in my flesh shall see God. So there's going to be a physical bodily resurrection. I shall see for myself, my eye shall behold, and not another. I am going to see it. I'm going to know it. Kind of like basically we're tossing faith out the window now. It's not a matter of just belief. You are seeing it with your own eyes. You know it's going to be there. And sorry, my atheist friends, if you deign to watch this far into the video, please continue to watch. Hopefully this is intellectually amusing at the least, and gets you thinking the most. You're going to see for yourself that, you know, here's God. Here he is. This is for real. You're not going to need some kind of other confirmation. You're not going to have to go through a list of proofs. You're not even going to need faith. He's going to be right there. And since Job knew God personally, he was able to throw in the last part, how my heart yearns within me. If you don't believe in God at all, and someone like that exists, that would be terrifying. At least I think it would be. Since I know him personally, I'm also looking forward to the encounter. Moving along in the Old Testament. So we're looking for something after this life that exists. So the Bible does have something to say about an ending. Something that's going to happen in the future. Something to wrap our existence up. Something to wrap this world's existence up. Let's go to Daniel. I do have notes on my computer screen here, because I actually prepared for this a little bit beforehand. Daniel chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. And this is only going to be, I put 1b through 2. Usually when you see letters after a number in the verses, that means like A or B, A is the first half, B is the second half of that verse. So, Daniel chapter 12, verses 1b through 2. So I'm going to skip to the half that I'm looking for. And at that time, your people shall be delivered, referring to Israel, and anyone who believes in God, everyone who is found written in the book. And many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting contempt. Now this elaborates a little bit more on what the Old Testament has to say about mortality, on a life after this, on the wrapping up of this world. It says, many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake. It's almost sound like some will be left behind. It's like some will wake up to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting contempt. So this isn't talking about seeing God. This is talking about there is everlasting life, everlasting contempt. So there's something that will continue forever. Apparently there's a good and a bad. And even it says, many of those who sleep, so this verse, at least if the English is being translated correctly, doesn't necessarily include every single human who ever exists. So it's almost like there could be a middle ground, like some to life, some to shame, and then some in the middle who just aren't resurrected at all. And it's not crystal clear. And I didn't do some deep Hebrew study to hear to see how exactly it should be translated. Gomen nasai, I'm still a weeaboo, even though I'm preaching. Gomen nasai means I'm sorry in English, by the way. It's not completely and totally clear. And in the Old Testament, these two verses, to the best of my knowledge, by all means, anyone else who's watching this video, type in the comments below things that I'm leaving out. Please elaborate on this message. You know, there's so much that can be elaborated on in messages like this, especially when you're talking about the life after this one. The Old Testament isn't very clear. You look throughout the entire Old Testament, you see things like the pit, the abyss, the grave, the land of the dead, and all that basically goes down to one Hebrew word, Sheol. And Sheol is translated in all those different things in English, and it simply means basically the place where the dead are. That place where the dead are doesn't mention there being any life there. It doesn't mention anything about consciousness. It doesn't mention anything about the state of being dead. It's just kind of like, well, nothingness, essentially. Nothing can really be gathered from that word other than, okay, this person's dead. It's about all that can be gathered. I don't think that when it translates as the pit or the abyss, I'm not sure if the Hebrew root word there is something about spiraling or descending or falling. I'm not a scholar. I'm kind of like a lay scholar. I try to look into this stuff to the best of my ability, but I haven't memorized Hebrew and Greek. And even though I went to a seminary type school, I didn't like in-depth study Hebrew and Greek and roots and all of that good juicy stuff. Maybe one day I'll get into that. Honestly speaking, I probably will not. I'll probably just be continuing my study in the English Bible from here on out and using the tools and references and resources that are available at my disposal, both online and in my personal library. And yes, my library is to the left of where I'm looking. It's where I get my Bible. It's on one of the top shelves of my bookcases. And yes, I have more than one. So, the Old Testament mentions some details. It's not like there's nothing, but it's definitely not the clear heaven and hell that the New Testament talks about, that churches and Christians talk about today. It's much more ambiguous back in the Old Testament. Why did God leave it ambiguous? I don't know. I do know that Jesus hadn't come yet. I know that there was much more to the gospel message coming that was going to come with Jesus. So there was a lot more to be revealed in time. I guess at that time, they had what they needed. They knew that there was something after this life. They knew that there would be something good and something bad. They knew there'd be a physical resurrection. And the New Testament simply elaborates on all of those things. I'm going to go briefly into the heaven and hell thing. Sorry, I still have a little bit of the cold from when I went out of state, where my body's like, I don't want to leave home. So I'm still kind of recovering from that. I'm sorry again. Such a weeaboo. At all times. So wonderful. Let's go first to 2 Corinthians 5, 1 through 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. Again, if you need to, just pause the video. I'll go ahead and start reading. For we know that if our earthly house, this tent, is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed with our habitation, which is from heaven. If indeed, having been clothed, we shall not be found naked. For we who are in this tent groan, being burned, not because we want to be unclothed, but further clothed, that mortality may be swallowed up by life. Now he who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who also has given us the Spirit as a guarantee. So the earthly house, this tent, obviously he's not referring to a physical home. He's referring to our physical body, this thing that we walk in and grab in and look with and live in this world. That's what this verse is talking about. So we desire the eternal. We desire something better, something more. And no, that's not a call to... That's not saying Christians want to die or want to commit suicide or anything like that. No, 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 no. It's simply saying that we know something better is coming after this. We have a better body awaiting us. We have a better home awaiting us. So we kind of want this journey here to be over, you know, at any time soon. Like, and Paul goes on to say later on in his writings, you know, that it would be that he's kind of like, I'm kind of torn. I kind of want to stay here with you guys, help y'all out. Kind of want to go home and be with my Lord. That's going to be in Philippians chapter 1. Look it up. Not going to provide you the chapter and verse there. And honestly, I didn't prepare it in advance. That's the honest truth. And, you know, again, Google behind me. Look behind me. See if what I'm saying is in the Bible. Is in the Bible or not. Look behind me. I'm human. I'm not perfect. And if it's not Philippians chapter 1, I will be quite ashamed. If it's Philippians chapter 2, I'll be like, doggone it. Why didn't I get that right? But so there's a very clear understanding of, yeah, we're going to go to heaven when we die. It's just kind of boom right there. Now, for the negative side of this, I'm not going to hop into this a lot, but just to acknowledge that it's there, hell. And this is going to be Revelation chapter 20, verse 11. Then I saw a great white throne, and him who sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away. And there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before God, and books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life.
And the dead were judged according to their works by the things which were written in the books. The sea gave up the dead who were in it, and death and Hades delivered up the dead who were in them. And they were judged, each one according to his works. Then death and Hades were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And anyone not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire.
Very explicit, very clear. The place for bad people, where they go to, is very, very bad. A lake of fire. And it's really interesting because that means hell is technically not the eternal state. Death and hell are thrown into this lake of fire. So hell itself will be ditched at some point. And this lake of fire will be the eternal resting place of the damned. Now, this particular verse does not talk about the lake of fire being eternal. I am inferring that from the everlasting shame that we read from in Daniel. And there are many other verses I could throw into the mix. There are many other things that I could bring up into the conversation. And I won't at this time because I would like to keep this under an hour. I'd like to keep it somewhere around 30 minutes-ish, maybe a little less. So, and again, study behind me. See for yourself. One of the biggest things I want to do with this channel is make people think. If they don't, you know, even if you're not willing to convert to Christianity, which I do believe is the right answer, and I do believe is the way to heaven, at the very least, I want to get people thinking about these things and get these things on point. Because the bottom line is, we're not going to be in this world forever. No one ever thought that this world and this life was going to last forever. And even if someone thinks that matter is eternal, it's all there ever was and all that ever will be, they will also be the first ones to admit that every human being dies. I don't think I need to prove that. I don't think any religion tries to disprove that. Well, probably, just knowing humanity, probably one or two did try to. And I know, I think wasn't someone trying to find the fountain of life or eternal youth, like back in the 1500s when sailors were exploring the world? So, yeah, people have all these crazy ideas and they try to avoid mortality. A lot, most of us try to avoid even thinking about it for the most part. Go, that's a bit scary. You know, not existing, not being here anymore. It's a terrifying thought, especially if you think that's all there is. But I don't need to convince you that all humans die. If anything, I would need to convince you that there is something past this life. Or maybe that a few humans actually avoid death, like Enoch and Elijah in the Bible. They actually skipped out on death, which I think is radically awesome. But I digress. Short of those few, my English got lost on me. Short of those two examples, every human being dies. It's also written in the book of Hebrews. Google it. It is appointed unto man once to die, and then the judgment. I actually covered that in one of my shorter sermons at some point earlier on. It's appointed unto man once to die, and then the judgment. One out of one humans die. And another quick tangent, some anti-theists attack religion as, you know, a scare tactic, like, you know, they're making people think about death, they're trying to force people to come into their religion because, you know, you're going to die, and you're going to suffer, and you're going to burn because you're an evil person, so join my religion, that'll make you safe, that'll make you secure. So we're like bad people who are using death to coerce people into believing what we want them to believe, into controlling them, into giving us money. And to some extent, that is true. Some people, even some people in the name of Jesus, do just that. I won't deny that. And it's a crying shame that that's the case. The way I view religion and faith in general, even faith outside of Christianity, because death is so guaranteed, and when you really think about it, it's potentially around every single corner. You don't know when you're going to draw your last breath. You don't know what crazy driver is going to be driving right behind you and crashing into your car and killing you tomorrow. You don't know what part of your body, without any signal, without any pain, without any symptoms, could be failing, and then tomorrow that part of your body collapses. And that part happens to be something important that impacts many of your other organs, and they successively fail one by one, and then eventually you'll die because of that. You don't know. And I'm not trying to scare you and make you think, oh my gosh, I'm not safe. I could die at any time. Let me rephrase that. I do want to make you think that, but not the intent isn't to scare you. If you think about it, that's simply logically true. We could die at any time. We don't know the day or the hour of our passing. We're not that much in control when you think about it. Human beings are awfully frail and weak. When you think about it, we don't know when we're going to die. We don't know how many more steps, how many more breaths, how many more heartbeats we have. And religion is there to address just that. Because that fear of dying is there, because death is so inevitable and so unpredictable and can come so swiftly and suddenly without warning, man wanted an answer to that. So religion's not some scare tactic for some, you know, invisible threat and some invisible man in the sky. Religion addresses a very real human concern that one out of one humans have to deal with, death. And that's why religion is there. And I do believe I have the right one. I do believe I found the correct God to worship in the middle of all this. So without going into some long apologetic rant discrediting each religion one by one, I'm going to once again focus on my faith, what I believe is true. I believe that the Bible is the Word of God. I believe that its message is true. I don't need to convince anyone of any faith that we're all going to die, but I do believe that since the Bible is correct and since I can believe it, I'm going to take it at its word when it says that there is a heaven and there is a hell. In the Old and New Testaments, it speaks of, we all know we all have an individual end, but this Bible speaks of at least some people having a physical meeting with God face to face. It speaks of this world having an end. It speaks of a heaven and a hell, a good and a bad place where souls go when they die, that this life is not the end, that this life is just really the beginning of our journey. You know, if you another way to look at it, like how long is the longest lived human being is what? 126 years? I could be completely wrong there. I've heard a lot of different numbers. Heck, if you believe the Bible, the oldest recorded living man was 965 years old. Methuselah. Ring a bell, anybody? But even with that long a life, he still died. Every human being dies. And I believe the Word of God when it says that there is a God, there is a heaven, and there is a hell. And my faith is what gives me strength when I think about the weakness of my mortality, the weakness of my dad's mortality, the weakness of my dad's mortality and anyone else that I love and care about, and my mom who has already passed. Death is inevitable. It's right there. And it's because of my faith in Jesus Christ that I can approach death with a bit of boldness and confidence and say, you know what? It looks scary. And I'm going to be honest. Death is a little bit scary to me. I can't say I'm completely unafraid of death because death can be painful. It can be terrifying. Some diseases eat you away for months and years. And then there are some depraved human beings out there that capture you and keep you until you die. And they treat you quite badly until the point of your death. Or they bring about your death very slowly and painfully, just because it's fun to those sadistic sickos. So I can't say the thought of death doesn't scare me at all, because sometimes the way you die can really suck. But I know once that journey is taken, and hey, God willing, I'll be an Enoch or Elijah. I think that'd be sweet, and I also think it's possible. Enough of my charismatic weirdness. I threw that in there, dropping that tangent. Short of that, at the point when I die, once I've gone through whatever experience, whether it be quick and sweet or slow and painful, that it may be, once that journey is crossed, once I'm no longer in this world, because of what the Bible says, I know where I will be. Now, you know, questioning, you know, whether my Bible's right or whether my God's right, that's a discussion for another time, and I will get into those topics. I want to get into those topics. There are so many topics to cover. That's why I don't plan on leaving YouTube for quite a while. I don't know. I don't know my own mortality. I don't know what God's going to help me to do, but I would like to stay on YouTube for a while because there's so much to talk about and so much to think about and so much to process. So I'm not going to defend those things, but given that this God is right and this Bible is right, there is a heaven and there is a hell. There is something past this death, the death in this world. So I am confident that when I cross that bridge, however long or short, and however quick, sweet, or painful that bridge may be, once I'm on the other side, I'm going to see my Jesus face to face. I'm going to have an eternity in a beautiful heaven. There's not going to be any sorrow, not going to be any sickness, not going to be any death. Read the verses right after the verses I read in Revelation. I read right up until chapter 21, which starts talking about the new Jerusalem, the new heavens and the new earth. That's some beautiful stuff. And I'm looking forward to it. It's not something that, again, death isn't completely unscary, but what happens after I die? I'm not worried about that at all. I'm not worried about not existing anymore. I'm not worried about my memory fading into nothingness. I really don't care whether this world remembers me or not. Most people are not put in the history books. Most people, within a generation or two, they're gone. That's it. Out of everyone's hearts and minds. Because, you know, second generation or third generation afterwards didn't even know the person. They're not talked about anymore. And that's it. You're gone. You're done. And that's the end of it. I'm much more concerned. If I thought this life was that, I'd be much more concerned about what I could get out of it and how much I could get out of it while I was here. But I don't believe this life is it. I believe there's a life after this. And I believe that this life that I live now will greatly determine what happens in that next life. So to get to the crux of this, how, you know, what do I need to do to get into heaven? Well, since I'm sticking to the Bible and the God of the Bible, specifically the God of the New Testament, Jesus Christ, I'm going to look at what he has to say about getting into heaven. And the term that I'm going to use there is saved, because there's something we need to be saved from. Romans chapter 3, verse 23. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And just another quick reference. I didn't prepare this in advance, so Google behind me. It talked about in Revelation how there would be a book of life. And those who are written in the book of life, those who were the ones who did not go into the lake of fire. So, and it also talks about back in Exodus, the Israelites have sinned with the whole golden calf and everything. And Moses said, God, if it would please you to spare them, and if you're willing to spare them, blot me out of your book. And God said, he who sins against me, him I will blot out of my book. Well, with that simple statement, and you combine that with all of sin and fall short of the glory of God, everyone's going to be written out of God's book. No one's going to be in the book of life. So we're all, by default, headed to hell. We're all headed there. That's the ultimate destination of every born human being, because we're all sinners. We've all sinned. So God, if he will blot sinners out of his book, then that's game over for all of us. That's it for all of us. I'm going to go ahead. There's another verse in Romans I want to get to, but I want to read. I'm going to read verse 23 and then verse 24 back to back, because I don't hear this done a lot in churches. So again, back to Romans chapter 3, verses 23, and I'm going to read through 24. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Verse 25, whom God set forth as a propitiation by his blood through faith to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance God had passed over the sins that were previously committed. So, oh my gosh, that is so juicy. But right after verse 23, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Verse 24, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. because of what Jesus did, there is a propitiation or a payment. That's a much smaller word. That's a $5 word as opposed to the $50 word there. And, you know, if you want the specific definition, again, Google is your friend. I say that so often in my videos. I'm going to keep saying it too because it's true. So there's a payment for our sin. And that's what the grace of God through what Jesus did. And that leads to the verse that I ultimately wanted to get to, which is Romans 10, verse 9. Romans chapter 10, verse 9. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Saved from what? Saved from sin. Saved from hell. And your name can then be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Jesus is the Lamb. You don't believe me? Feel free not to believe me. Look it up. A lot of people have already heard the whole Jesus is the Lamb thing. A lot of people are already familiar with that particular biblical analogy. So according to the Bible, and according to the God of the Bible, we've all sinned. Sinners can't be in his book. Jesus died for us, and through grace, he shed his blood for the remission of our sin, becoming a propitiation for our sin. And then, if we call on Jesus and believe in him, we will be saved. And then our names will be written in the Lamb's Book of Life. His blood washes away our sin. Our name is allowed once again in God's book. And then heaven is where we go, not hell, by his grace. So that's a lot of, there is so much that I could unpack there. I didn't set the timer once again for this video, doggone it. So I don't know how long or short this has been. But please consider that one day you will die. And at that, you know, right now you have a chance to think about, is there a hereafter? Is there a heaven? Is there a hell? Is there anything? And if heaven's real, what do I need to do to get there? I haven't presented cases against other faiths. I've presented the case from my faith. For me, that's the most important first step. I have time later, at least I think I will. I don't know my time or my day or hour. I don't know when I'm going to die. But as far as I know, to the best of my knowledge, I will have time to talk about and against other faiths and religions later. But right now, I want to present the case for my faith in Jesus Christ because I believe that's the ticket to heaven. Will I go to heaven when I die? Yes, because of Jesus Christ and because of his death on the cross, him shedding his blood, being a propitiation for my sin, because of that, I will go to heaven when I die. Not because of anything that I've done. Nowhere in the middle of all of that talk of seeing God in the flesh, seeing with my own eyes, a resurrection to life, a resurrection to shame and everlasting contempt and death and hell, being swallowed up in the lake of fire, anyone's name not found written in the book of life was cast in the lake of fire. Nor in the middle of any of that do my works come into place. The only thing I can say about my works is I'm a sinner. I'm a sinner. And I need God's grace to save me. If my words have swayed you, one, I like to say it's not my words, it's the Holy Spirit. I can't save anybody. God is calling you right now to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. So God is calling you to himself. Just tell him that you are a sinner. Admit that you are one. Admit that you need his grace, his unmerited favor. Another way to explain his grace. Tell him that you believe that he died on the cross for you, that he shed his blood to forgive you of all your sin, and that you believe he also rose again on the third day. Because Jesus didn't stay dead and buried. He is alive and he is well. He's sitting on the throne at the right hand of his Father, and he is waiting to admit everyone into heaven who calls on him, who wants to be forgiven of their sin, and will admit that they need his help, that they need his cross and his resurrection. And if you want a prayer to guide you, if you want something specific that you can pray after, I'll lead a prayer real quick. If you don't want to do it in your own words, you can pray this prayer after me. Just mean it from your heart. Pray, Lord Jesus, I admit that I am a sinner. I admit that I have fallen short of your glory. I admit that I need your help. And I believe that God, you died on the cross for me. You shed your blood to forgive my sin. And I believe that you rose 3 days later, guaranteeing eternal life for me in heaven with you. So please save me now, Lord Jesus, and forgive my sins. Wash me completely clean. And thank you, Lord, that you've done as I've asked by your grace, and that one day I will see you in heaven and I'll be with you forever. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. If you just prayed that prayer, one of your own, welcome to the family. Welcome, welcome, welcome. It is wonderful to have you, and I mean that it is wonderful to have you. There is a verse that says all of heaven rejoices when one sinner comes to repentance. So if your sins were just washed clean by the blood of Jesus and you accepted him as your Lord and Savior, heaven is rejoicing. I'm rejoicing. It's awesome to think that I can, like, tell people this good news that brought me out of all the despair and all the misery I was in and has led me into a life where I'm not afraid of death anymore. At least, I'm not afraid of what happens after the death part. I'm not afraid of what happens after I'm out of this world. Once I'm dead and gone, I know where I'm headed. And now you know too. Now you're there with me, and you'll be there with me. And everyone else who's called on the name of Jesus, find a church who will encourage you in that faith. Find people who will encourage you in that faith, who will encourage you to read the Word of God, who believe that the Bible is the Word of God, people that believe that Jesus Christ is Lord, that he died on the cross for their sins and rose from the dead. Find like-minded people who can encourage you in this newfound faith you got. Find a Bible, read it daily, and talk to God. Prayer is simply talking to God. Talk to God about stuff. Thank him for what he just did for you. Thank him that you're now free, that you're something new, that you're different than you were before, that you're going to go to heaven and you're going to be with him forever now that you believe in him. And you know, if you have problems, talk to him. Tell him you need his help. And it doesn't matter. It can be something as tiny as all the mic problems that I've been having on YouTube. It can be something as big as my dad's dad dying of cancer and facing death imminently. From small to big, God wants to hear you. So talk to him. That's all prayer is. Plain and simple. So if any of you guys have watched the video all the way through, thank you very much for that. I appreciate the support. And more than that, if you did accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, please let me know in the comments. That's an exciting, exciting thought for me that I can give this good news that I found to other people. That excites me so much. And that's the primary reason I'm even doing this whole YouTube thing. I love video games. I love anime. I'm a huge weeaboo. Boku wa otaku desu. But more than that, I believe in Jesus Christ. And I believe that he died on the cross for my sins, rose again the third day, and that I'll be in heaven with him forever once I leave this world. Thank you guys very much for watching. I love you guys. God bless.